Hi, this is Pastor Greg here for Voice in the Wilderness Bible Church. We're setting up a discipleship program, and I thought I'd do a sort of an introductory presentation to kind of get you into the mechanics and what might be involved. This gonna be sort of a short one, but I thought it might help you give a little foresight here. And the first thing I want to say is the music that we opened with there. It's from Rush, from the 2112 album. I know it was came out, what, 74, 75, whenever. It's a progressive rock song, and it's a song called Lessons. And side A of the album is actually all the songs are part of a story. And the story is sometime in the future, there's a new age society, and where they're pretty controlling, controlled by the high priest. And one guy happens to find a guitar that had been sealed up and hidden away, started playing it and loved the music it played. And so he brought it to the high priest, and the high priest scorned him because they feel that the prior society's downfall was due to music. Now, I thought it was kind of appropriate, you know, the theme is somewhat parallel to discipleship, because, you know, we see a lot of churches now that they may get a lot of people in and you know, have good numbers and everything, but they're not training discipleship. I don't have people come up to me and talk to me about Jesus out on the street. You know, it's I don't know, it's something that yeah, I don't see much of. And anyways, so I thought I'd set up a discipleship program. Now, I want you to note that this program or classes or however you want to call it, this is actually tailor-made to two of my members. But generally, I think it can work, you know, overall for other churches, you know. Like, if you want to, if you ever find that you want to use it in your own ministry, tweak it however you need to, you know. I mean, but you see some key words here just to get the get-go. Disciple. What is a disciple? Well, in the Greek, the Greek word, and forgive me if I'm pronouncing this wrong, is mathetes. And pretty much all it means is a student or a pupil, a disciple. Now, I got my Bible open here to Matthew 28. Or I did. Oh, I got it. Matthew 28, and we'll pick it up at verse 18. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." That's what's known as the Great Commission. This is what, there's a few things, you know, Jesus wants us to follow his way, but there's a few things he told us to do, and this is one of them. Make disciples of all the nations. Let's take a look at relationship. Now, I can sit behind a pulpit and preach and teach till I'm blue in the face. Now, generally what will happen is, either they'll get their hour nap in, or they will be filled with the Holy Spirit, you know. But is that teaching them discipleship there? They may have taught something, or, you know, they may have learned something, but a relationship is indicating two or more people, you know. It's like prayer, you know. You can pray, you know, God, I need to win the Powerball, you know. But if you don't listen to his answer, which for me is always no, then it's not really a relationship. So in this course, it's pretty heavy on discussion, you know, it's all the way through. And that's just kind of how it is, you know. Now, you'll see me mention in some of the slides core member. That is actually the two people that I picked out in my ministry to go through this. But it would be somebody in your own ministry that you see, they don't necessarily have to have a spiritual gift of teaching and all that, but somebody that's motivated in Christ, who's willing to, you know, volunteer, and you know, you'll see them when you see them, you know. Now, I'm not going to touch too much on this accountability, but this is kind of, see, this model, up to a point, can be used for small groups too, but I don't know at what slide 5 or 6, whatever it is, then it starts to get pretty different between the two models. But the accountability is really, I'm accountable for teaching the disciple, and when they're ready to teach, you know, discipleship to someone under them, then they're accountable to them, plus they're accountable to me. And mention who I'm accountable to at the get-go is Jesus, so try to get it as right as I can. So we'll start with the presentation. Okay, here we see a church full of people. Actually, it was a picture of just a picture of a crowd that I got off the internet. And I thought it was going to come out better. It turned out pretty grainy, but hey, it works. From here on out, though, for the next few slides, the background will be blue, so just consider the blue background in the next slides the church. You know, on a local level, I don't mean the whole body of Christ, but just the local level. And what we see here are a box and a circle. Like I say, the box is, you know, as the arrows pointing the church or small group. And I don't want to get too much into the small group thing here because it's kind of a different thing, but up to this point, the model is the same. So just wanted to point that out. Now, what we have in the circle is the discipleship nucleus. And in my personal case, it consists of me and two of my members, which chosen core member. The core member, that's where that comes in. Now, as a small group leader, it's the same thing, but like I say, I don't want to get too heavy into the small group thing. So it's my job, as you see the arrows, to chosen core member to make disciples of them. Now that's all pretty self-explanatory, so we'll continue on. I'll have my cat Spaz click the clicker. Thank you, Spaz. I have a little kitten, he's pretty rambunctious about getting on my computer. Anyways, okay, here we see kind of the same picture, but now the core member now are the disciples. And you see the pastor, small group leader, and the chosen core members. Now these are two different members other than the slide before. So in theory here, in our training, we've made two disciples for our church. We have a pretty small church. That's why, I'm not bringing this out as small groups, because small groups, the dynamics start to change a little from here. So from here on out, it's just discipleship. But you may see in the next couple slides where it says small group leader. Just kind of ignore that. Now here we see somewhat the same picture as before, except now at the bottom tier there you see members, four circles with members. Now kind of in theory here, each disciple, using the example from before, trains two disciples. So you can see disciple one, it's got two members, member one and two. Disciple 2 has two members, members 3 and 4. Now, you see a pattern here growing. Now, the one thing that has been brought up to me about this and been discussed is, isn't this maybe like a numbers game? Let's throw them a carrot so we're going to get more people in the pews. It would be, I guess, but the main reason is to, as I said before, the Great Commission, what Jesus told us to do, make disciples of all the nations. This is actually putting in the church, this is actually putting in more knowledgeable and Christ-centered members, instead of the guy that goes to church once a week, says he's spent his hour with God, he's a Christian, hallelujah, So we'll continue on here. Now here we see the course breakdown. Now it's pretty self-explanatory right there. I actually got four phases on here, but for all purposes, considered only the first three. The phase four theology of this ministry is still in the planning stages, and I haven't begun work on it yet, but the phase four is going to be more academically inclined instead of relationally inclined. I mean, it still will be, but it will go on pretty much deep into it. But phase one, understanding Christian life. Phase two, the discipler training. Phase three, amplified disciple concepts. And now you would think we start at phase one and continue to phase two and then phase three, but for me training a leader or a couple disciples, what I'm doing is training leaders. So for those two people, and like I said before, I've sort of tailored this for these two people because I know them very well and I know their strengths and weaknesses. So that's what the course is kind of geared for. Like I say, if you use something similar to this, you tweak it to your own needs, but for the first part, I'll be starting out with phase two training. It's training the disciple how to disciple, basically, actually what it is. Then when they start to train new Christians, then they start at phase one, then go to phase two and phase three. And remember how you seen the circles in the prior slides. Each one will pick out a member or two members, whatever. I don't suggest going over 10 members because then you start losing the care factor, the person, the personal factor, you know, the relationship factor. But when they pick their trainees out, I guess, for lack of a better word, then they start at phase two with them. Does that make sense whatsoever? I'm not explaining this so well. But anyways, this is the phase one, two, and three. Like I say, phase four is still works in the progress here. So, patience, Lottie. Now here is phase one. It's a sort of a condensed syllabus, I guess you'd call it. There's 16 lessons in this phase. And so you ask, how long does this take? And while you're looking at your watch, you know. But figure on an average about an hour per lesson. So we're setting it up for one lesson per week is what it is. And you know, so 16 weeks here. Now give, you know, after, probably figure an hour for the first one or two of them, but and judge accordingly to your own group and whatnot. But what it is, remember, we're heavy in discussion on this, so it could last longer, or if nobody says anything, 15 minutes, you know. I encourage you as a discipleship leader to get discussion going, you know, because that's when the questions get asked. And when you ask questions, don't ask yes or no questions, you know, because pretty obvious, you know. If you can invoke some response that can actually bring in more questions, then have a pretty good meeting. And like I say, we're figuring about 6 months total for this phase one. The whole program between all three phases is at about, on the average, will be about a year and 3 months, I think, somewhere in there. Now here we're looking at phase two, condensed syllabus. There's six lessons here, and this is the one you want to train your potential leaders first. So for your potential leaders, this is where you go at first, and for your new Christians, you know, you go back to number one. Okay, now we've made it to phase three. Now, phase three consists of four segments. Part one and part four are only one lesson apiece. And part two and three are split. I think there's 16 lessons all together. So it's between two and three is, what, about seven apiece. I don't think it's equal, but that's what it averages out to. Next. Phase 3, Part 1. The Christian Life Summarized. Okay. Phase 3, Part 2. Well, we have seven lessons here. You can look at them and kind of see what they are there, and kind of get an idea of maybe what you're getting into as we go on. Phase 3, Part 3. Now you see at the end, discussion points, that there's a lot of discussions. In the model I'm taking this off of, there isn't a lot of discussion, but I've tailored it for each lesson to have a lot of discussion. And here we have part 4 of phase 3. And the last lesson. And contrast between walking in the spirit and walking in the flesh. Pretty important concept if you ask me. But that will conclude. Oops. Hit the wrong button. That will conclude the actual discipleship training. Like I say, I'm setting up a fourth phase, and that's going to be a lot more in depth. Okay, here we have phase 4. Like, I'll just read it. I haven't started to produce this phase yet, but it will be more academically inclined, geared to teach the theology and doctrines of this church, in order to produce leaders that can take over as lead role in the church. It will be heavy in discussion and study from a biblical standpoint. Now, this is where we'll discuss theology quite a bit, you know, the justification by faith and grace and mercy and characteristics of God, and I haven't got it all how I'm going to write it up yet for a lesson plan, but that's kind of where it's going to go with that. Now with that, I want to thank you for putting up with me here. When we start the lessons, I suggest highly, and in fact, I'm almost going to require it, is you bring a Bible of your choice. I won't be teaching all the KJV verses and whatnot, and a pencil and a notepad, because some of this stuff you'll want to take down. Another thing we will be doing is one verse memorization, and that will be from the lesson itself. You'll see in a lot of the lessons once you get into it that there's some verses, you know, they're not all just one verse per lesson. It's that there'll be a verse memorization. And then I'm going to require after each lesson that the person that's in the program read one chapter out of the Bible and come the next meeting, discuss which chapter and kind of what it meant and what it meant to them personally. And this way it helps provoke discussion. I'll prod them, get my cattle prod out and prod them with that. But with that, I hope you've enjoyed this as much as I have. So, God bless.
What can this strange device be? When I touch it, it gives forth a sound. It's got wires that vibrate and give music. What can this thing be that I